So we will start our session. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you all doing well and safe. Welcome to all of you again in our session. It was a long day. I hope you enjoyed all the last sessions. My name is Jumana Saidani, third year transportation of hydrocarbon student in the Faculty of Chemistry and Hydrocarbon, Boumerdes, Algeria. I will be the moderator for this session. Okay, we have this program for today. We had two sessions before, and this is the third and the last session for today, which will be about the geophysics for the current energy market. Now, without further, please welcome with me our special guest, Mr. Amine Ourabah. Mr. Amine Ourabah is a geophysicist with a long experience in the oil and gas industry, covering many aspects of seismic acquisition. Amine was a part of a development team that created the nimble node technology, which led the creation STRYDE, where he will now hold the position of head processing. Amine has a particular interest in the high-density seismic acquisition and processing. Mr. Amine, can you hear me now? Please.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, it's an honor to have you today.
And thank you for accepting our invitation.
And you can just share your screen now. You can start to share it.
And okay.
Now I will just mention, ladies and gentlemen, I would remind you kindly to write your question in the chat box. And I mentioned too. We're gonna share the link of the attendance sheet in the chat box as well. Don't forget to shake it and fill it up. Now, yes, we can see your screen, Mr. Ourabah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
So morning, afternoon and evening, everyone. Well, thank you for inviting me for this conference. It's been a while since I gave a talk at Boumerdes, so it's as someone said, it's probably one of the great things about COVID is that these kind of virtual meetings have become very common and much easier to set up. I didn't quite know what to cover given the diversity of the audience, so I went for something very very broad and very much like that at the end of the presentation, we have a proper discussion. As I always think, it's the best part of these kind of intervention is really that interaction with the students at the end, because that's what the end, this is for, is to kind of give some ideas and motivations and some open doors and windows to what's happening in the industry from a career perspective as well. So geophysics in the current energy market, whatever that means. I'll go through the few aspects of what is geophysics and why it is so important to still believe that it's going to play a role in the future of the different energy markets that are emerging these days. So I'll go through this outlines on the screen. So I'll give a brief overview of geophysical methods, because although I'm used to give talks to geophysicists, I think what I'm understood from Friel is that the audience is not particularly geoscientists. So it's always good to just go briefly through what are these methods and how do they work. I'll talk about the current utilization of geophysics in the hydrocarbon exploration industry, and then from there we will see how geophysics will play a role in the emerging energy markets. Talk about challenges and solutions to support these industries, and that's actually where opportunities will arise, especially from students and early career professionals' point of view. And then we will finish with conclusion, and hopefully we'll have a lot of time to discuss and have answer some questions, or maybe even ask some questions. So overview of geophysical methods. It's been a while since I looked at something else than seismic, but I try to capture all the geophysical methods that are used out there, and actually they use it in a way that are they create an industry or a business in a way. So seismic is by far the most used and probably the most expensive part of the geophysical methods used for different industries. We've got other methods that are measurements of different physical parameters of the Earth. So we've got gravimetry, you've got magnetic, which by the name, you know, you probably would guess what they measure. Then we've got electrical resistivity, which consists of either injecting a current in the Earth or just measuring the what we call the spontaneous polarization of the of the ground. And other methods are more towards the EM spectrum. So electromagnetic is something that is often used for very near surface, so a few centimeters to a few meters below the surface. And then we've got obviously the well logging, which is by itself, it can be anything of the above applied in the well logging sense, which means that the tool is put into the well bore. And you can have several measurements, which can also be seismic, electricity, electric resistivity, or something more bespoke like gamma rays or the radioactive measurements. And then we've got another set of geophysical measurements, which can all be put into what we call remote sensing, which are usually measurements that are made from satellites or something that is orbiting the surface from very high ground. Examples are maps that are done by specific satellites. It could be also LIDAR that are remote measurements of the elevation of the surface. And then you've got any part of the spectrum that could be UV or infrared that also gives some information about some kind of absorption that could be related to different conditions on the surface. So apart from the two on the bottom, which are a combination of different measurements, but in a certain made by a certain tool or a certain way, the rest are geophysical methods that are very commonly used in different industry, whether it's oil and gas, mineral exploration, or geotechnical industry. So to answer, I'll just try to get rid of this. What geophysical method you should be using? It's a bit tricky, but you could probably ask yourself the question: is what's your depth of investigation? Because all these different methods I mentioned earlier have very different depth of investigation. Some of them can be a few inches under the surface; others can go to kilometers under the surface, all to the point that you could, you know, image the whole planet actually with some of these methods. The other one is resolution. So some of these methods have a very high resolution, others have extremely low resolutions, and resolutions tend to be inversely proportional to the depth of penetration. So most of the methods that have very high resolution have a very shallow depth of penetrations. Others that have low resolutions tend to have extremely high depth of penetration. We'll talk about seismic, which is somewhere in the middle, but that's a general kind of observation. And last and not least is that it's important to know what you're trying to see in the subsurface. So what are the physical measurements you are making, as is illustrated by this scan of banana on the screen. Banana would look very differently whether you're looking at it through an X-ray, an MRI, or through a CT scan, which means that if you use seismic methods, usually what you are imaging is the impedance, which is the difference in velocity and density from one layer to another. If you look at the resistivity you are looking at the electrical resistivity of the subsurface, which usually is linked to the presence of minerals in the pores or in the matrices. GPR, for example, is very sensitive to absorption. So all these different methods will see a very different picture of the subsurface, and some of them actually are overlap, others they don't overlap at all, and they are very complementary in certain conditions. So that's obviously something to bear in mind. And that's something that is very common to any method you're going to be using, is obviously the cost and the feasibility. So even if one method is probably the best method for you to achieve a certain goal, if the cost is too onerous, obviously you will never be able to apply it. And the feasibility is the same thing. So some methods can be affordable, but are unfortunately you cannot apply them in a certain conditions, and that's something that you have to bear in mind. I'm a geophysicist specialized in seismic industry, I'll pull a few slides from what I'm more aware of, and that's seismic. So just briefly to explain what seismic is. So seismic exploration or seismic imaging is a way of imaging the subsurface using sound waves. And to do so, you need to usually to inject certain source seismic energy in the ground. And then you receive that energy through a receiver system, which at the end you end up with a set of data set, which you have to process to make an image of the subsurface. There are two types of seismic acquisitions. One is a land seismic acquisition, another one called the marine seismic acquisition. There's also something in between called the transition zone, but just for simplicity, we'll skip that one. Same stuff for the land. You will need a source. Usually it's either vibroseismic, which is this truck you see here on the background, which can has a plate, hydraulic plate right in the middle, which shakes the ground with a certain frequency, a sweep, which we call a sweep, which can go from 1 to 180 or 200 hertz. And those frequencies go in the subsurface, and they are reflected at every interfaces. And then they are recorded by a receiver system, which one of them is actually the one my company make, which is our called seismic geophones or seismic nodes, depending on what kind of system you're looking for. In marine, is a similar principle. It's just that the receivers are towed behind a vessel, so they come in very, very long cables. They can be 20 kilometers behind the vessel all the way around here. You don't see them here on the picture because they are under the water, but they imagine you've got about 20 kilometers behind you of a streamer. It's a cable basically which has a lot of receivers inside. And right in the middle here, what you can see in the middle, it's the source. So the source in marine is what we call an air gun. So this is a compressed air that is that shoots every at irregular interval shoots bubbles, and those bubbles actually create an energy that goes down the water, bounces back at interfaces, and goes back and is recorded by those streamers on the back. For a fact, the seismic vessel and the streamer is believed to be the biggest man-made object, moving object on the planet. So this system is quite huge and quite impressive. So just to give you an idea on why seismic is powerful, but also why it's very complex actually to process, is when you go to a seismic acquisition, that we're going to see on the surface, you're going to see a source and receivers. So not much for you seems to be happening, but then when you this is just an animation showing that the vibroseismic is shaking, and when it shakes, that's what happened on the subsurface. So there is a wave that goes, and given the depends on the complexity of the subsurface, that wave is scattered, refracted, reflected, and it becomes a real mess before it goes back to the surface captured by the receivers. So what we call the wave field is an extremely complex set of data set that needs a lot of processing to be able to extract the information of the subsurface to make an image that makes sense for the interpreters to turn into a geological model. So on the left-hand side, this is an example of a raw data set. This is what it looks like. As I say, a raw data set wouldn't make any sense to anyone unless you do some processing actually to turn it into an image that would make sense for the interpreters. Just for the, give you some ideas of the time it takes. So seismic acquisition can take several months to a couple of years. And actually the processing can also take several months to a couple of years. So, you know, Imagine you take a picture and then there is the results of the picture would be delivered to you in 6 months or sometimes in 2 years. That's one of the biggest challenges of seismic is actually the turnaround, which is very slow compared to, for example, other methods like GPR, which you can see the image straight on the screen while you are doing the survey. Obviously, the depth of penetration is very different and the resolution is very different. Just to say that geophysics is, you know, it's not just for oil and gas, although oil and gas has pushed the geophysics technology to its limit. And that's one of the reasons is because that's where the money has been for quite some time. And that's usually what's needed to push any type of technology or any type of business. These are just screen grabs from what geophysics is used for. Obviously oil and gas, you've got landslides, you've got seismology, you've got aquifers, volcanology, of course, geothermal, civil engineering, called geotechnical and geothermal. Even for space exploration, you know, the probes that have been sent to Mars recently actually do have a seismic system, which is one source and one receiver. Which is the one in here you can see, and actually it has already been doing some seismic since last year. So geophysics has got a very broad application, although it's very known to be a common tool in hydrocarbon exploration. So I'm just going to explore a few a few very promising industries that are extremely important and extremely, in a way, they can't be avoided if we want to reach the net zero era. You know, we are, well, most of us, a lot of countries are promising the world in the next 20 or 30 years. And these industries are the carbon capture, utilization and storage, and you probably have heard of it as named CCUS. So this is technology where it's been around in the oil and gas for a very long time, actually. The CO2 has been used as a sweeping product to increase the oil and gas the oil production in the fields, but nowadays with a lot of oil feed being in depletion or actually completely abundant, you've got this opportunity to take the CO2 from the most heavily CO2 producing industries like iron and cement and the chemical industry, and capture that CO2 and inject it in specific layers, whether it's an old oil and field or specific new layers that are dedicated for CO2 storage. And to do so, yeah, there's two important things in here that geophysics can play an extremely important role is that, first of all, you need to find the right host for it. So whether the host is known or not, you will need to make an image of the subsurface to know where you're injecting your CO2. And once the CO2 is injected, you need to monitor that CO2 to make sure that throughout the duration of the life of the field, that CO2 doesn't escape and stays where it's supposed to be. Because if CO2 escapes, it's not only the fact that you're losing CO2 into the air, which is defy the first idea of capturing it in the first place, but also it can be extremely dangerous. So especially if it's below aquifers. So if the CO2 goes into an aquifer, unfortunately it doesn't give you just fizzy water. It will actually turn that aquifer into sometimes a very poisonous substance. So for different reasons, which we can discuss if that's something that interests you. So geophysics plays extremely important role here in finding the right host and also monitoring the CO2 throughout the life of the field. Another related also industry, what's called the blue hydrogen. So blue hydrogen is a combination of finding a gas field and combining this with the CO2 storage. So as you know, when you have a gas field in production, there's a lot of CO2 that is produced, and usually that CO2 is either left to be introduced in the atmosphere, but to be to become for the blue hydrogen to become when you extract the hydrogen from natural gas, by definition, because the chemist of you would know that the carbon and the oxygen would be extracted from the methane, and then that CO2, rather than being left to go to reach the atmosphere, is actually reinjected into the field, whether it's the same field or something that is nearby where the CO2 can be stored indefinitely. So within that cycle, what's happening is that you basically are creating hydrogen with no CO2 emission. That's what it's called blue hydrogen. So it's one way of creating hydrogen. There's other ways which are more conventional. It's like the one that is linked to electrolysis, which is called green hydrogen. So this is the old methods that we all learned at high school, when you put electricity into the water and then you get hydrogen and oxygen. That's called green hydrogen. So unfortunately for the green hydrogen, you need a lot of renewable energies to create that hydrogen in the first place, and at the moment it's not extremely efficient. So at the moment the most likely source of hydrogen, if hydrogen becomes a fuel of the future, is actually natural gas that is turned into hydrogen, and then the CO2 is captured into the subsurface. Another industry that is extremely promising is geothermal. We're seeing literally a boom in the geothermal industry in the last couple of years. So geothermal is actually a very broad field. It is, we always think about geothermal like the spa we see in Algeria, like the one you see in Hammam Maskhoutin, for example. But you've got so many varieties of geothermal sites that can go all the way from generating electricity with a water that has been heated at a certain depth, turn into steam, which can turn turbines, which can make electricity, then to something that is less onerous, like heating villages or heating industries that are very hungry in terms of heating bills, and then down to heating houses, or even heating your own house with your own, basically what we call a heat pump. Sometimes you could heat you can help some industries to produce food with a reduced carbon footprint, like greenhouses. So if you can imagine that you can heat a greenhouse with water that has been heated from geothermal, you've got basically free heating, and that has got huge impact on the cost and also what you can grow in certain countries. Iceland is very famous for this. They even managed to grow bananas in Iceland by heating heating the greenhouses, but also creating electricity from the geothermal there. Very prosperous geothermal industry, and that made them one of the biggest producer of bananas in Europe, apparently. And then you could all go to the opposite side of geothermal, which is rather than heating, actually cooling the air through the geothermal. So this is called negative enthalpy geothermal. That's something that's is started being looked at in the Middle East, and that also has a huge potential in saving electricity bills and CO2 emission from the current energy sources used for cooling. On the right hand side, what you see here, this is also a cool company called EVA that BP has invested. BP and Chevron have invested in very recently, and that's what we call a closed loop geothermal system, where you don't, rather than injecting the water into the geological layers, you basically build a radiator at 3,000 or 5,000 meters. So by creating several horizontal wells under in the subsurface at an area where you've got a very good what we call temperature gradient, you can circulate the water inside those pipes or those horizontal wells in a closed circuit. So therefore, you don't need to frack anymore, you know, and you have a full control of your fluid movements, and that obviously you have an injection well and a producer well, and that's, you know, the water goes in cold and comes out on the other side hot, and that also can be used either for heating or for generating electricity. The mining industry also is an industry that will be here for quite a while, especially with the need for those rare metals for the battery industry. Examples of lithium and cobalt and what have you. So all these minerals will have to be explored for and also managed during their exploration. So geophysical methods for these industries are quite limited. So usually it's more EM methods or resistivity methods. Seismic has been used for mainly for coal, but now it started being introduced to mining of certain metals like copper and iron. The mining industry is kind of going through the same oil and gas industry. So it's now that the easy field that what we call outcropping into the surface have nearly all been found. And now what's left is our mines, our sources of these minerals that are actually much deeper than what has been found before, and in much, much more complex systems. And when we say complex system, that's actually where geophysics comes in. So it's the same as the oil and gas. You know, when the oil was seeping at the surface, very little geophysics was used. And then when all those fields were, or locations were found back in the early 1920s, that's where actually people started looking at geophysical methods to look at more complex fields by, you know, imaging the subsurface with geophysics. So the same thing is going through. The mining industry is going through the same curve, and at some point, what we're already seeing this now. The mining industry is requiring a lot more geophysical expertise and tools to be applied to their industry. One more thing is which I found quite cool, probably not very promising, but I really quite like the idea, is that some of the gas that we, you know, we never think of them as being something that you could grasp from nature directly. People are actually looking at some sources of these gases in the field. Two of them is actually hydrogen and helium. So hydrogen, as we spoke about earlier, usually we think of it coming either from electrolysis of the water or from the natural gas, but native hydrogen do exist, and there is a field in a quite decent field that has been found in Mali, a couple of years ago. Can't remember the name now. Buraka Babu, I think. And it's so these fields are natural hydrogen that comes straight from the subsurface. Usually the way it's made and it's produced is still, you know, being discussed, but mainly it seems to be that it's linked to the water being close to some radioactive rocks, and that radioactivity actually heat and was it just break up the water molecule, and then that was so hydrogen is released and goes into the surface. And the way it's found at the moment is by this looking at those what they call witch circles. So the cercle de sorcière, that's how they call them. And that's because the hydrogen, when it goes in the surface, it changes the pH of the ground, and actually it kills most of the vegetation. And by just looking at Google Map, actually you could start finding some of these fields around the world. And as I said, you know, this is something new, started coming a couple of years ago. And geophysics obviously will have huge importance for these industries to make them successful. Whether it's by, you know, once, for example, you find a field like this, then you could bring some geophysical methods to see actually if there's some kind of a fracture or some kind of a basement where these hydrogen are seeping to the surface, because for most of these resources, you need to try and go and, well, dig deep enough so that you can capture the hydrogen as close as possible to its source before it starts diffusing into the surface, because capturing it at the surface is a bit too late. You know, you lose a lot of the gas already that has been dissipated into the subsurface. Native helium, same principle. Helium is it's very scarce gas, and actually there's a lot of prediction that that the world actually will run out of helium in the next few decades. So it's there's very, very little, very few helium source of helium sites, production sites around the world. I think there are three or four around the world giving helium to the whole actually world industry. So looking for helium is something that is being looked at quite carefully. There's some companies that are dedicating their business actually for native helium exploration, and they are using methods that usually were dedicated for oil and gas exploration, or for example seismic, in combination with other methods that are more linked to the geochemistry. The one last one is the underground storage of radioactive waste. So this is something that's been around, well, since the beginning of the radioactive the presence of radioactive waste in the industry. So well, few sites around the world actually are dedicated for these kind of storage. So once the waste comes from nuclear stations, usually thus that waste is managed either at the surface, but there are there's a trend into building dedicated underground storage sites. There's a couple of these in France, for example. The company used to be called Andra. Have a very a site actually south of Strasbourg, I think, between the French and the German border, where they have a site where they store that waste in a reversible manner. So these are tunnels actually that are drilled and built 500 meters to 1,000 meters under the under the surface. And those radioactive waste actually are pushed into those channels in a way that they can be retrieved in the future if there is something, if there is a need for that. And obviously to find the right host for this radioactive waste and to monitor actually that everything is staying in the right place. Geophysics is actually the best method for that. And you can see that different methods will give you a different perspective on the way your site is actually being surveyed. For some of you who are keen on looking at what the sustainable development goals look like from the UN perspective. I don't know, this has become a really very hot topic in the last couple of years. So on the left hand side, this is, if you go to the UN website, you will find this sustainable development goals called SDGs, official disc, and they describe one by one how any industry should do that its job if it wants to be sustainable. So if you work on in an industry, or if you want your industry actually to move to a sustainable way, you should in theory find your goals or the way you work or the objectives fit one of these descriptions. The SDG actually has made an attempt at mapping the geophysical industries or different methods in a way into each one of these SDGs. Can't remember which one, which number of the leading edge I think this wheel went on, but if you look at it on the internet, I'm sure you can find, if you just type geophysical sustainability wheel, you will probably find it. And what they've done is that they've taken most of these SDGs, and actually they described how geophysics could have a role in each one of these, and that's it's really important, because then if you want to go into the geoscience world and the geophysics world in a way, it's very important to know how you could sugar coated, saying that how your role as a geoscientist or as a geophysicist will make the world a better place. And your role should, in a way, fit inside one of these wedges in a way or another. If it doesn't, you probably should start rethinking the way you want to progress your career or your business. Depends which part of the world you are. So just an example from the business I work in, and the business I'm more familiar with. So, just taking the example of the seismic industry, I think what's needed now to enable those new industries and to allow each one of these wedges actually to reach its best is you need to support those industries in a way or another by making geophysics more accessible to them. Whether it's accessibility through cost or accessibility through the skills or the tools, you will find, hopefully, when you enter these industries, that there's a gap of knowledge, and there's a gap not only knowledge and feasibility in a way, compared to the oil and gas industry. So the oil and gas industry has used geophysics to be so successful, and they pushed it so much to its limit. But there's I would say like a 50 years gap between what oil and gas industry is doing with geophysics compared to what other industries are doing. And that gap has a meaning and has a reason, and that's in a way, that's why these new renewable industries really do need to realize the value of geophysics or geoscience in general in making them successful. So on one side, these industries need to realize the value of geophysics, but us as geoscientists, what we need to do, or geophysicists or geoscientists or anyone who's interested in the geoscience, our duty is to make those methods or knowledge or technologies available to them. So this is kind of a two-way, and they need to meet in the middle so that, you know, their business would be a success and hopefully the world would be a better place. So the way, you know, we think our business, or my business in the seismic industry is helping is, for example, by replacing these old and bulky systems and heavy systems and expensive systems that are have been used in this industry for ages by something that is really nimble and light and neat. And by doing so, what we're trying to achieve now is really to reduce the cost and reduce the HSSC exposure and reduce the time, and therefore making seismic a very affordable tool to anyone who needs it. So whether you're working for the geothermal industry, we're looking for the mining industry, or even for the archaeology, some of these industries would never have thought that they could afford to do seismic. And that's what we are trying to achieve in mine company, in a way, is that we would like to make these this tool affordable to anyone, not only the oil and gas. And the same thing should happen to all the other industries. So whether you're working in an industry of the remote survey, we talked about electromagnetic or resistivity, or any tools that can allow you to measure a physical property of the earth. If you want to make that, you want to make your tool have an impact in the future of our net zero future, you need to make it affordable and accessible to industries that don't have the same deep pocket as the oil and gas. One nice example from the impact of the system we're making at STRYDE, for example, is that in the seismic world, the seismic industry is very common for people who are using cable system to cut lines through forested area to allow those cables and vehicles to move the cables through the survey area. Those line cuttings are obviously is very damaging for the environment, but also they're extremely dangerous because you need to cut trees about 3 or 4 meters wide lines throughout the survey. So when people do this, especially in environment, well, this is an example from Siberia. And, you get people working at minus 43 degrees in here. So by allowing to have a nimble system that can be just put on the backpack, you don't need to cut trees anymore. So obviously there's a huge impact on the environment. So things like this are, do change the way people work, and obviously change has a huge impact on obviously on the environment, on the HSSC, but also on the costs. And when you talk about cost, actually that's when industries get interested to you, because then you give them another kind of access price to your tool, whether it's seismic. This is just an example because this is what I do, and I don't have any other examples from other industries. But I hope you get the point that making a tool accessible and affordable is extremely important to help these emerging industries. So that's the cost and efficiency on the left-hand side, which I just covered. But the other thing is that is the skills. So what happened recently with the downside, with the downturn of the oil and gas, is that what we're seeing is there's a huge, huge number of highly skilled people from the oil and gas that have either left or pushed out of the oil and gas because of the downturn. And these people, some of them have completely left the industry and started doing something completely different, but some of them also are kind of migrating their skills into those new renewable industries. And that's very important. So it's also important to show that the geophysics or the geoscience is not only for the oil and gas industry anymore. And if you want to play, you can still be a geophysicist or geoscientist and play a huge role in enabling those new renewable industries and make the world a better place. So it's important to still go and look for convince students that geoscience is actually a career that is worth pursuing, and also having a lot of these skilled people that have left the oil and gas industry pass on their experience and their expertise into this new generation of geoscientists that actually can take it and apply it to those renewable industries. So just to finish, so I got a few numbers from a magazine about the worth of the geophysical market, and you can see, you know, I just read for you, just the global geophysical services market is expected to grow from 12.8 billion in 2021 to 13 billion in 2022. That's a compound annual growth of 4.6%. So that's quite fantastic growth, you know, especially given this the current market, and also with the world going through this pandemic, and you know, the last sentence said that the market is expected actually to reach 15 billion by 2026. This is a very healthy market, and you know, if the question that comes from you or expect from you is that, is there still a future in geophysics? I strongly believe that the answer is not only yes, but also that geophysics and geoscience in general will have will play a key role in actually in the net zero era. And the aggressive hiring schemes that used to drag geophysicists by default to the oil and gas industry, especially in Algeria, since most of the audience from there, is just to say that this situation is no longer inescapable in a way as it has been. And however, this is also means that the life of the students, the graduate is not as easy as it used to be, because most of people who have graduated in some kind of petroleum engineering, what have you, by default, they would have gone to an oil and gas company or a contractor. But nowadays, it's probably slightly harder to find a job. But still, it means that you need to, in a way, be a bit more innovative, a bit more motivated. And also, very important is really to demonstrate your value and the value of whatever you're doing to this renewable market. So so there is still a very promising future for whoever wants to stay in the geoscience industry. That's it from me for you. So I hope it wasn't too long.
No, it was a really beautiful session. So thank you very much. I think as you mentioned from the start, we would be starting the discussion. So I'd invite our guests to open their mics and maybe ask their questions or their remarks if they have anything to add or to ask.
Freddy.
Hello. Thank you, Amine, for the great presentation. I got two quick questions, though. I'm not sure you can hear me, right?
I can hear you.
Okay, so I got one question regarding actually when you have showed in one slide that you guys are... I have to say first that you are using geophones and then those tools. But I was wondering, because I'm assuming you do borehole seismic as well. And then I'm just wondering if you guys are working with fiber optics.
We don't do fiber optics. So we are working on surface seismic. Fiber optics, which is called DAS, is provided by actually another sister company. So we are three startups that have been created by BP a couple of years ago, and one of them is called Light, LYTT, and another one is called Fortech, FORETECH, and the other ones actually are specialized in DAS, distributed acoustic sensing, which is for fiber optics. So what we do is different. So we are more into the conventional seismic industry, where you do seismic from the surface using, it's not geophones, these are nodal systems. So nodal systems are the sensor plus the recording system all in one, in that little carrot you saw on the picture. That's not just a sensor, that's the whole recording system inside.
Okay, thank you. Then I got another quick question, please. Sure. If we go to the geothermal slide, then the company that has been like, where we have the investment in between Chevron and BP, I'm just wondering if the applicability, as let's say, of the project is like in terms of domestic usage, because I have heard, I'm not sure about this information, but like when you are fracking your rock and you let your fluid go there and then you get it back from the other side, it gives the fluid actually enough time to get heated to temperatures, like to generate steam and then electricity at the level of like oil and gas. But when it's like running in tubings, the fluid doesn't really have time to get heated enough, and then probably it's used for domestic usage. Is it the case for this company?
No, that's a very good question. That's one of the biggest challenges actually for what they call closed loop or geothermal is the transmissibility of the temperature through the casing. I believe that's why they are drilling so deep, and then the number of horizontal wells is also very important. So they drill at about 3,000 to 5,000 meters, so that's 3-4 kilometers under the subsurface, which is very deep, and especially if you pick an area with an extremely high temperature gradient, so you could easily reach 180 degrees or 20 degrees at those depths. And then I suppose that the casing is not the same as the one you would use for normal drilling for. Okay. So I don't know much of the details, but yeah, I'm sure if you go to the EVER website, you'll probably find more details about this. But it's an extremely important point, actually. That's one of the biggest challenges for these types of systems.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello, can I ask a question here? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you perfectly.
Thank you. Thank you, Mohammed. Thank you, Amine. This is Mohammed from Schlumberger. Thank you very much for the very insightful presentation. And I also would like to congratulate you for the latest CCUS-related seismic monitoring on the leading edge article. It was a really outstanding article. Thanks. My question was about the hydrogen emanation fairy circles you discussed. I think you mentioned that the article from Isabel Moretti. That's the only article I found discussing such a fairy tale circle. So are you aware of any geophysical project on exploring these kind of structures?
Well, I'm trying to get one. So I'm working with Isabel on, we did the first natural hydrogen conference last year. It was called 8 year. If you're interested, have a look at it. I think we're going to have one in Morocco, and half of it is going to be virtual. And the reason for that is we really want to attract as many people, as many investors into those this kind of industry, to see if they can demonstrate if there's any tool actually that can help the natural hydrogen exploration for that one. The helium, I'm aware of that. So the helium, there is 48-5. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's a small startup that was, funded by Total. It's based in Po, and they have acquired a seismic survey 3 or 4 months ago for helium exploration in southwest of France. It was quite a success, actually. So there's the area was very, very well known for helium leakage already. So there's a huge fault, and if you go to the streams or to small ponds around the area, you could see bubbles of helium coming up to the surface. So they acquired quite dense seismic around the area to not to image the helium itself, but to image the faulting system, so that they can predict where the helium, where they should drill, so that, as I said, to capture the helium as as close as possible to its source. So to answer your question about hydrogen is probably too, it's not mature enough, and probably we're looking for a couple of years before we find a geophysical method that could help with that. But I think, you know, seismic is probably one of them. But for helium, yeah, it's already being done.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome, Mohamed.
Is there a moderator?
I guess, because we do have some questions in the chat, right?
Okay, so I'm not sure whether I should go ahead and speak or ask my question, or whether I should wait for the moderator to give me the right to
I'm actually an alumni from the SP student chapter, and I'm allowing myself to you can go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question, actually.
Okay, very good, very good. You'll have to forgive, Mr. Amin, you have to forgive my ignorance of the field. I'm a physicist, not necessarily a geophysicist, with a very strong interest in space sciences. So my first question is more philosophical than technical. You know,
I love these questions. Go ahead.
I do not want to open Pandora's box. However, you know, your presentation has been primarily technical on basically showing some techniques as how geophysicists deal with certain issues that are of dramatic impact, that can have a dramatic impact. I mean, my superficial knowledge in space science, I mean, why would you invest into a technique that is very dirty? Say, for example, for extracting lithium, right? It's a very dirty technique. And we do not know, I mean, we really do not know how to deal with lithium once the batteries are done, and God knows what these big companies are going to do with these batteries. How the other issue that I have is helium. Helium, the scale height of helium is way, way up. I mean, you have to go 15, 20 kilometers up before you start finding helium, because its scale height doesn't want it to be on the ground. So if you're gonna look for it in the ground, it's gonna cost you a lot of money, and it's gonna be very expensive. And once you extract it, you know, it's not going to be to stay there once you use it. I'm not sure how one can justify these techniques based on an argument of sustainability or an argument of net zero. Net zero for me means there's positive and there's negative, and you add them together and you get a zero. So the negative part is definitely there, and we sweep it under the ground. I mean, people who say, well, we need windmills and things like that. I tell them directly, you know, the windmills are made of iron. You got to extract the iron, and that extraction is very expensive. So you're hiding it, saying that the wind is going to do things for you. So how do you justify that as somebody who deals with companies, who deals with the extraction of all sorts of things from the ground?
It was a very philosophical question. To be honest, I really don't have a clear answer to your question, because your question is more on the downstream of what we do as geoscientists. So we are an enabler for whatever that person wants to do with that geophysics. So in a way, what I think, you know, geoscience in general would be able to do is to make that exploration much more efficient, and it will reduce the waste of energy and the waste of resources these companies will put or will have to put anyway into exploring those resources as long as there is a demand for it from the world market or the world in general. Those companies will go and do it. So it's the same as for the oil and gas. As long as there is demand for oil and gas, people will just go and look for oil and gas, whatever it takes for that. Same for lithium, the same for iron or what have you. So unless we are all prepared now to stop using our mobile phones and cars or what have you, I think there is no escape from that. Now what geoscience can do is make that exploration as nimble as possible and as neat as possible. So we don't, well, for the mining, for example, if a mine will have, well, you know how big mines do work. So if you go to, if you are exploring for lithium and you will have to dig 1,000 square kilometer of, well, basically dig a whole city space for a town space to extract few tons of lithium. Now with geoscience, you can be more nimble and more focused, and it will help you to focus that energy into something that is more informed. Same for other other tools. You know, that would be my answer. But you know, it's the world is moving towards a future that we don't, really don't know what we're going to be using as resources. But you know, to be pragmatic, I don't think we can go away from, especially we definitely won't be able to go away from oil and gas and lithium at the same time, if you see what I mean. Freya, are you praying the moderator? You could probably pick up the next question if you...
Actually, I'm the moderator, sir, but there's issues in the connection, so I'm so sorry. Okay, we can pass for the next question. I don't know if anyone have another question, he can just keep the mic and ask you a question directly.
I mean, you could pick a question from the list and just ask that person to...
Yes, we do have one in the chat. Brahim is asking, what are the tools that can be used to control the helium storage?
Oh, I have no idea. I'm not really into the helium business. What I know is that the helium is, you know, has a tendency to be extremely difficult to capture, to be captured at the surface. And what's important is really to go down and capture it as close as possible to its source, whatever that source might be. So that's the limit of my knowledge around helium.
Okay, we do have another question from Deepanshu. He's asking, any specific countries where geophysics market is active?
Oh, it's everywhere. I don't know of any country that is not using geophysics in a way or another. So obviously the application is different. So Middle East is mainly focused on the oil and gas exploration. We're seeing huge urge for geothermal. So in Europe, Switzerland, Belgium, Netherlands, Germany, France. It's a lot of activity in geothermal in those countries. CO2 capture as well. So we're seeing this a lot in the northern countries of Europe. Whether it's a big project coming up in the UK and in Norway, there is the geothermal also is picking up slightly in North America as well, and the carbon capture, and mining is usually it's very active in Australia and China. So Yeah, anyway, you go, there's geophysics, really. It's just that the application is different. Sometimes it's more on the oil and gas, sometimes more mining, sometimes on the geothermal, sometimes it's land, the other ones sometimes in marine, but it's there in a way or another.
Thank you. I guess we do have another question, but this was like asked earlier, and I am assuming that it has been asked when you showed the slide for the geothermal, saying that is this actually the boom currently? So Akinmuda was asking, does this mean actually that we should deviate our attention from hydrocarbons exploration and development?
Well, it's a good question. You know, it's but that's why you will hear very often in, you know, these days something called the energy mix. So the energy mix means that the world won't be able to get rid of oil and gas in the next 30 or 40 years or 50 years, well, at least probably more than that. And what's going to happen in the future is that the source of energy is going to be a mix of different, different sources I mentioned here. So by using geothermal for heating, for example, you will need less oil and gas for electricity to go for the heating. So then that's how things is going to work in the future. I think the oil and gas will still be here, and it's still a business that, you know, you could obviously go into, especially if hydrogen becomes the source of the future. Basically, gas exploration will probably be just as intense as it is now, if not more, especially with what's happening these days with the political issues around the world. So oil and gas is very interesting, and it is going, you know, it will have a big share of what's going to be a source of energy in the future.
So we can pass for the next question if we have.
Oh, sorry, I was muted because I was reading the questions in the chat, and it looks like we don't have any questions anymore in the chat, except thankful messages. One of the guys, Hedy, actually is saying, thank you.
Sorry, you're muted. I can't hear what you're saying.
Oh, yeah, sorry. He's just saying, thank you, I mean, for giving hope to geophysicists, confidence and numbers.
Yeah, I can see a quite interesting question from Deepanshu. It says, how is geophysics useful in gas hydrate exploration, and should we acquire some more skills along with geophysics? And yes, it's becoming more important now to have more skills than the one we, you know, used to have 10 or 20 years ago. Is that tools that used to be, or skills that used to be specialized, like, you know, programming skills or machine learning, for example, is, you know, it's becoming something that is a very hot topic these days, or other actually more soft skills, more like business oriented skills. All these used to be people that were specialized in those different fields. Nowadays is actually not the case anymore. You know, you have to have some kind of knowledge into those industries to make, to make you different from somebody else and make you more hireable. So I would, I would highly recommend, you know, for people, students starting their career, or maybe they're being in a university, aiming to get a career in geoscience, is to really acquire those skills as early as possible. You know, doing Python, for example, needs to be something that you a bit like a second language for you. You know, at least you don't have to be proficient to, in the sense of you can, you know, program software with Python, but at least you need to be able to put your thought into a program and demonstrate actually that you can make a tool of what you think is a solution. Same for machine learning. Now those days, you know, machine learning used to be something that you have to create from scratch, but not these days anymore. You could, you know, there's something called transfer learning where you could have a framework of a certain methodology that you can bring to geophysics and apply it and have something that is a working tool extremely quickly with if you know, obviously if you know what you're doing. Same from the business side, you know, knowing how to prove your value to a certain business is also extremely important, and have a kind of a general knowledge of what the challenges of these different industries. So for example, go and learn a bit about geothermal. What is geothermal? What is a binary system? Why geothermal sometimes works, sometimes don't? And then you project your geophysical knowledge into those challenges, so that you can come up with solutions. So I highly recommend, for anyone interested in the geoscience industry to kind of broaden their skills. Yeah, and Mohammed Amrosh is obviously he's got his talk I think tomorrow about geophysical applications for new energy. So I'm sure he will dive into more details about all these kind of applications for probably including geothermal, etc. So looking forward for that talk.
I just want to remind you, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to just ask, you can unmute yourself and ask the Mr. Ourabah directly. And if not, you can Mr. Ourabah read the question, or I will read it for you, because what do you think? What do you prefer?
Yeah, read them if you can find them. I don't think.
Yeah, exactly. Some of them want to talk directly, and some of them just write it in the chat box. So please, guys, just to control and manage the thing, if you want to ask, raise your hand up and start talking to know who will talk and who will write his question in the chat box. That's it. Thank you so much. We will see. I think there is this question here in the chat box. I will just check it. Thought call micro seismic. This is the top again also. Here someone asked you, Mr. Ourabah, can I have the name of any petroleum geophysics 3 or 4D interpretation? This is the look.
I don't think I understand the question. Sorry, if the person is asking for a book or a person or... I can't answer that question.
Okay. I think no more question. Wait.
Yeah, I see something
There is a question, Mr. Yeah, there is a question. Can microseismic wave use in the study of oil and gas?
Yeah, well, microseismicity is you know, can have different meaning really for different people. So there are a couple of things that I haven't mentioned here, but yeah, microseismic is one of them. Microseismic is usually used to image the fracture network during the fracking. So when I know fracking might have a negative connotation in oil and gas because it's linked to shale gas, but it's not all the time. So for example, geothermal use fracking to increase permeability so the water can go can flow more easily from one side to the other. So when you frack, you could that was micro frack, you know, fractures. Can work your fluid fracking the subsurface for you, so you will end up with a branching image of your fracture, and then it would inform you actually if your fracking is doing a good job, because then you would know if you know if the fluid you are injecting is going to the right direction or is it escaping somewhere else where you don't know. So that's usually called, that's what micro seismic is referred to in the industry, whether it's oil and gas or the geothermal industry. There's another method called, which is different, it's called what's called passive seismic. So passive seismic is when you record continuously without a source on the surface or somewhere else, or sometimes could be also in the wells, but usually on the surface. So you record passively the ambient noise, and then you can use the ambient noise to create what we call virtual sources. So you can turn every single receiver into a source by doing a multitude of cross correlation between receivers, and by doing so you will have actually something that would look like an active seismic, but it's not, it's just the receiver system recording the ambient noise around it, and it's mainly surface waves, and those surface waves actually can be inverted to give you an information of the subsurface. And during that passive recording, you can also record, if you're injecting a CO2, for example, you can record the propagation of your, what we call the plume of CO2 inside the reservoir. And that information can be also inverted to give you an information about the direction of the propagation and the extension, the horizontal extension of your injected injected gas. So those roughly what, you know, micro seismic or passive seismic would refer to in industry.
Mr. Ourabah, I think no more question. Everything is clear. Thank you so much. Thank you for your presentation. Thank you for your time and for your energy. And we are so sorry because we distributed your program. We're sorry. No, and yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thanks for having me. It's been really great to see. I wasn't aware of your program at all. You know, I used to come to go to my because I've done my first engineering degree in Boumerdes, ENH, and I used to go there, you know, every year or so to give a talk in person, you know, to students. And at some point, I just stopped because things changed a lot since those days. And this is a great way of reconnecting what they call alumni for different in other countries. And it's actually, it's very important to use actually those people who left the industry and who left, you know, your own universities and went to the industry, because there's always a very special link between the students and those people. And, you know, there's I'm sure a lot of them are willing to give back to the students in the university they came from. And so this is one way of doing it, and hopefully this is the beginning of a series of events like this, repeating events every year. So thank you very much. And
thanks for you. Thanks
and
for
good
you.
Job. Thank you. Good job.
Thank you. You so much. Thank you so much. Bye. So ladies and gentlemen, so thank you so much for being in this session. This is the end. This is the last session for today, but the geoscience series is just in the beginning. We have a lot of informative and important session waiting for you. Make sure to attend it and don't miss it. Thank you so much for your attention, ladies and gentlemen. See you next time. Thanks for the time, Mr. Ourabah, again. And thank you. Goodbye. Take care. Be safe. Thank you.
Goodbye. Bye.
Goodbye. Thank you.